I'm following my candidate. God keep a land.
Dun dun, and a tune of song and free.
And free.
This world is to
be stand on guard.
Bless you.
All right, men, bow your heads for the men's prayer. I'm a man,
and I can change if I have to. I guess.
Oh, my goodness. Hello, everybody. It's 12:01. We do that in honor of our friend Dan Loney today. It's 12:01 here in beautiful Seattle, just 90 minutes north of Langley in supernatural British Columbia, from which our keynote speaker speaks to us today. And for you Canadian clock watchers in Newfoundland, the Atlantic ghost time is 7:30 last weekend.
Yeah.
Hello, my friend. I'm George Toles, and this is his deal. So honored to be with you here in this safe gathering place for men who are curious about Jesus Christ and what he taught. You know, with Pat O'Day's passing, a great cheerleader in our city, I was reminded today of the 1979 NBA Championship Series. And my friend Jack McMillan remembers that very well. And when the 24-second clock shot clock or the game clock has been drained down to the last tick or two, the coach wants his money player in the game. The guy who desperately wants the ball, he's willing to put his team on his shoulders and carry them to the final buzzer. For the Sonics, this was all number 24 from Pepperdine, DJ, Dennis Johnson. With ice water running in his veins, DJ would flash a glance at Sigma down on the low post, then at JJ in the corner, then Captain Freddie was set up to launch from downtown, and that glance from Dennis said it all. It said, give me the ball, I'll take the shot. This is what Pat O'Day said a week ago in this very Zoom room, interrupting the flow of our conversation and what remained of his scratchy, now cancer-free but emphysema-stricken lungs. He barked, George, we've talked about radio for 30 minutes now. When are we going to talk about my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? What we know now, what Pat was really saying was this. What Pat was really saying was, only a few ticks left on my game clock, God. I want people to know that by saying yes to God's offer of forgiveness for all their sins, they can pluck victory from the hands of defeat. Victory in Jesus from the jaws of defeat and hell. Each of us makes the personal choice of where to spend eternity. Pat chose Jesus. And this prodigal son, you know what he's doing? Right now, he's popping corks. He's popping corks, and we all want to be with him. This is going to be a phenomenal day. We've got so much great stuff in store, and I'm so glad that each one of you has joined us. Two good friends are going to be hogging the microphone today, and this is interactive, so we want to hear from you, your input, your questions. We've got just a stellar lineup of us this summer. And we will get back to Bible study. We return in November. For those of you who may haven't been with us for a while, we have special speakers for five months and Bible study for seven. Keep me on the straight and narrow here, Curtis. Keep me straight. Okay, so our next Zoom will be on August the 5th. No, it won't be. It'll be on August the 26th. Bob Beal will be with us. Bob is our guru for some 45 years. He's been an executive mentor in the areas of personal and organizational development. He's worked with some 500 senior executives and about 5,000 team members, giving them the tools to focus clearly, achieving maximum productivity. Bob's been a generous friend of his deal for many years. And if you go on our resources section of our website, you'll see all kinds of wonderful tools for that Bob has provided for us. Doug Peterson will be with us on the August 26th also. He's been a client of Bob's for about 2 years, and Doug's business has gone into orbit. Let's see, it's time for our This Is Your Life. It's a wonderful feature where we kind of go in depth and get to know the guys a little bit better. And today it's going to be my friend Bill Corson. Bill was raised in a secular family. He began following Christ at an early age, served as a Navy corpsman, an EMT, the Marines, and then 32 years with the Long Beach Police Department. He worked in narcotics enforcement and undercover operations. We'll find out if he ever met our friend Joe Friday while he was out. Then he went to, he married Karen, what a beautiful lady she is, and they moved to Riverside where they attended the Harvest Christian Fellowship for 8 years. Bill was an assistant pastor and youth pastor there. Greg Laurie is the senior pastor, and I'm happy to say Greg dropped in on us when we were back in the Nordstrom boardroom and spoke to us one day at his deal. Bill and Karen have a daughter, Jessica, and three sons, Blair, Jared, and Justin. Two of those young men have been with us at his deal. 30 years ago, they moved to Washington, and for 22 years, Bill was a Redmond policeman, helped develop and led the SWAT team, active shooter training. You don't just do that in the afternoon for a lark. This is crazy stuff. Crowd control and riot team. The Corson family works with nonprofits to develop programs for at-risk youth and their families. And he's been in business 25 years in this adventure outfitting company. And now he and Karen are focusing on helping others experience an authentic faith and life in Christ. Bill, you've got our attention. This is your life. Bill Corson. Let's give Bill a thumbs up, huh?
Thank you. Thank you very much. You know, thinking about this and seeing where my life's gone, it really is a signature of God. And, you know, he works in so many mysterious ways, but in his providence, in his grace, in his goodness, he continues to lead us. You know, there's a song, I mean, reaching youth has been our life, and growing men has been my particular part of my existence. But there's a song by Toby Mac right now that talks about the words go like this. It says, call it a reason to retreat. And that to me is like where we're at today in many things, a reason to retreat. And I think kids, young people find many reasons to retreat away from seeking the great things in life. And so did I in early years. I'll tell you about that in a second. But he said, I got some dreams that are bigger than me. I might be outmatched, oversized, the underdog for the fight of my life. It's so crazy to believe. And then it says, you gave me the stars and you put them out of my reach. You called me to waters that are a little too deep. Oh, I've never been so aware of my need. You keep making me see it's way beyond me. I think that's kind of where my life started. It was way beyond me in the things that we did and where we went. But I was born in Hermosa Beach, California, beautiful little beach town and called the South Bay of LA, in a time where LA was totally different than what it is today. It's kind of like La Conner. Huntington Beach was like La Conner, open fields of vegetable stands and the beaches were open. The little town that I'm from is crowded. I couldn't even tell you. There was a little body glove shop was called Surf and Dive, or Dive and Surf. And the brothers there would rent tanks out. And when I was born there, it was a magical land for me in some ways at the beginning, that I saw this adventure side. A lot of divers, surfers, and adventurers would leave Redondo Beach Harbor and go out on some adventure. So as I grew up there, I began to see this yearning inside of me. And my family was really not a Christian family. And my mom was very young when she had me, and she struggled. Greg Laurie's story, if you've ever heard his story, is very similar to mine. It's really crazy. But the fact is that my mom got involved in drugs and got into affairs, and life seemed to be pretty much swept away. But, you know, the really crazy thing was, is I walked to this church about three blocks from my house and I sat down in the back of the church and listened to the preacher teach about Christ. And my parents, everybody tried to find me and they brought me home and my parents were asking me, what are you doing? And for the years to follow, my dad was became a police, a CSI guy, way back when CSI wasn't cool, the LAPD. And as he got a job in Long Beach, California, we had to move to Long Beach. And where we moved to Long Beach, we basically, when we got there, my neighbors would go to church and I would ask them, can I get a ride? And so in third grade, fourth grade, fifth grade, I started just going to church. And sometimes I would just walk there and listen to God's word. And God just was drawing my heart. And in the summer of 1966, at the age of 11, I got an invitation to go to a Christian church camp, Angelus Christian camp. And I went there and I basically played this part of Jesus and of calling Lazarus out of the tomb. I was short. My mom was leaving home. I didn't have anything in my life. And all of a sudden I'm playing Jesus in this play and God just reached out and touched my heart and changed me forever. And so I went back to church, was baptized, and my family started going to church. Some of my external family gave their life to Christ and were baptized back then. But so at the age of 11 and 12, I started moving into seeing God work and reading scripture when I could all alone, but I wasn't discipled really. And I kind of floundered in those years a little bit. But all of a sudden that year, something changed for me. God transformed me from this awkward, dyslexic kid that wanted to learn and wanted to be something. By the next year, God radically changed my life. He grew me in stature. I went from one of the shortest kids in the class to above average. I was a forward. I started playing sports and I was a forward on the basketball team. And my scores went from hurting to way above average and to where I was just, God must have just changed my mind. And everything about me changed. In the next 3 years, a couple teachers got into my life. And it's, you know, there's a book by Jim Collins. It's Start With the End in Mind. And so I'm starting with the end in mind, in a sense, is that a couple teachers got a hold of my life and basically said to me, hey, Bill, what do you want in your life? And they're both Christians, but they never really preached at me or taught in the school. And they said, have a dream, like that song I just shared with you, have a dream. And I had that dream and I wanted to have a good family. I prayed for a good family. I prayed, in a sense, I wanted to be an ER doc is what my dream was. And if not, I wanted to be a police officer, but my dad didn't want me to be a police officer. And one thing I wanted to do if I was a police officer was be on the SWAT team. This is 1967. I was having 1968. And I had a goal to play on this volleyball team that they had. And so I set these goals early in my life as I sat there looking over my dad's police magazine that he had called The Rap Sheet in his bedroom one day. And I went back to school and said this. Anyways, at that time, who knows what was going to happen, right? But I grew up in Long Beach when the gangs became the gangs. The Crips became the Crips and the Bloods became the Bloods. And they came through my neighborhood. We were a very diverse neighborhood. They came through my neighborhood all the time. They stole our bikes. I mean, there's so much violence all the time. I couldn't keep a bicycle. If I didn't fight, my little brother would go to the park. Sometimes they'd point guns at us. And sometimes there were shootings. And it was a pretty hard time to grow up on the west side of Long Beach. But we had all these really cool guys that I got to play sports with. And in those days, those guys were incredible. From Anthony Hill, Tony Hill, Dallas Cowboys. He was one of my best friends. We grew up together. And all the guys, we just kind of lived in sports. And so sports became my life. And I went to Long Beach Poly High School, number one high school for football, for NFL players playing for the football. And I got a chance to play a lot of sports there and excelled in that during those days. And I kind of just drifted away from seeing God and serving God. But by my junior and senior year, he just grabbed me and pulled me back in and started changing me for good. I met my wife, Karen, at a football game where I rescued her from a couple of my friends, football players that were being very stupid and sitting down by her. And I went down to rescue her. I didn't even know her. And I ended up rescuing her. And she was 15 years old then. And next year will be our 50th year together. But we went through high school together and then later on moved into USC where Karen and I had gone to Long Beach City College where I started playing football. And the coach basically was my defensive back coach. He said, "Hey, Bill," we were playing volleyball one day when we weren't playing football. And he saw me playing volleyball because I grew up playing volleyball at the beach. And he said, "Hey, Bill, you need to be on the volleyball team." So that changed my direction in sports a little bit from baseball to football. And I got on the volleyball team at Long Beach City College. And then later I transferred to USC where I spent some time there in the ROTC program. But it was really difficult. This is a beginning of a change in my life. It was really difficult for me because when I was there, it was, I struggled with idols, and like we all do. First of all, Karen became an idol to me because I just wanted that relationship with her and I depended on that relationship. And sports were an idol to me. I spent 5 hours a day on the court practicing sports and I tried to get involved in my fellowships with my guys, but I just couldn't. And then Karen's parents wanted us to date other people while we were at college. So that we knew that, and that scene wasn't really good for me. I didn't like that because it had too many temptations and stuff in it. So I was kind of spiraling and I knew I needed something. And I decided to quit my junior year at SC and move to the full-time military. And I went in the military again in my life and I sat next to my locker in tears, bald and nothing. Again, and going, "What are you going to do with me, God?" And God he started making me with him first. It wasn't about anything else. It was me and God by myself. And he started building me up because the minute he started building me up, he focused me on others. The guys, and I became a squad leader for our boot camp and I started helping the guys and teaching them stuff. And they came to me. And then one night, they said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm praying, reading my scripture." And they said, "Would you pray for us?" So upstairs, they asked me one night to pray for them. So I prayed for everybody upstairs. And the next day, the guys from downstairs said, "Hey, I heard you prayed for the guys upstairs. Would you come down and pray for us?" And I said, "Yes." So I came down and I prayed for them. And God excelled me in athletics again. I broke a record on the obstacle course in the military. For the Navy that year. And it was me, God, and it was leadership. That's what God grew me in. And those guys voted me. I got the most outstanding recruit for our platoon, our company, and my life changed. So I went home basically with a changed life, God first. I got rid of all my idols and Karen came back to me after that year, and our life was solidified from there on out because I got it right. I wasn't like trying to mix in everything else. It was me and God first, and then it was life after that. And so for years, the next years after the military, I got a job in Parks and Recreation, and I just was making like $1.85 an hour to put myself through school. And I needed to keep my grades up because I wanted to get in med school and I had to keep it above a 3.8, you know? And so, Karen and I were working, she graduated from SC. We were trying to make it through our times. And I worked I became a parks director for Parks and Recreation, which needed a master's degree. And the miracle was they liked what I did and they gave me the job. it got us married. Karen and I got married then after I got that job, and I was going to quit and go to full-time med school if I could get into school, and Karen was going to work. And bam, as soon as we got married, we had that beautiful boy, Blair Corson, which some of you guys have heard his testimony. So basically what happens from there is that God takes me to a job that I go to work for McDonnell Douglas because I'm trying to, they give you a scholarship to school if you can work for them. So I went to work for McDonnell Douglas and as an engineer, it was called process engineering, electrical engineering. And the job was a little bit bigger than I could really stand up to. I excelled there, but my boss lied for me to get the job. He said I had more engineering in my background than I really did. And it just ate me to pieces. I couldn't live with that lie. And so about a year later, I'm just going, what am I going to do, God? How am I going to get through this? And so all of a sudden, Long Beach PD had its first test in 3 years. And all my friends said, you know, why don't you test for the police department? You know, you've wanted it all your life. So what happens there is that I just prayed to God. I said, God, I want to never lie. I want to totally be honest. I don't want to have, you know, embellishing anything. I just want to be me and go forward. So I couldn't get to med school anymore because we had Blair and we were going to raise our kid in the right way, not halfway. And so Karen and I decided that the police department might be a good thing to do. And my dad kind of decided, hey, I'll let you go for it. Went there. I got out of, I think it was 2,500 applicants. I got like number two. And God just moved me through the police department. I excelled there. I loved it there. God used me there. And everybody knew I was a Christian there. I didn't have to hide it at all. And as God moved me through here, it was a great time. My son Blair was born, like I said, and then we moved to Harvest Christian Fellowship. So we decided we would try to find a home, and God brought us all the way to Riverside, which was like 58 miles away. And we went out there and I asked my wife, okay, Karen, you find the church because I'm always leading, you know, and I wanted to find a place where we could fellowship. And she found Calvary Chapel of Riverside. And I had been involved in the church early on in the Jesus movement, you know, when Keith Green was up in North Hollywood and all the things were going on. There was a great moving of the Holy Spirit back in those days. The friends of mine that were heathens doing crazy things on Saturday were all of a sudden coming to faith and changed forever. And I just talked to one yesterday. His name's Terry Adkins, preacher and teacher up in Meadow Valley, California. But I watched these guys just radically change forever and go through seminaries and start their lives and go in other directions. But God had this call on my heart to be for him alone. And I was doing all these other things. And so when we went to church the first Sunday, Greg basically said that, hey guys, we really need people in the children's ministry. I don't do children's ministries very well. I do okay the older kids, but little kids, I don't. That was a hard one for me. But so Karen and I, at the end of the sermon, Greg once again asked for help in the children's ministry. So we raised our hands. And by the next week after I put in my resume and my application, they said, could you teach Sunday school? Could you teach junior high? And I started teaching junior high, and pretty soon God just started growing our church out of nothing into something huge. And the kids started coming, and Karen and I started growing the youth ministry there. And then I had a pivotal moment. I have a couple of these moments in my life, but there was a guy that was running the high school ministry, and he felt challenged by me because I was a police officer and all this other stuff. And what I wanted to do as a police officer was, my job was for the first 5 years of my career was just be a good street cop, learn to do it. And you know, the funny thing, I was to tell you a little story there, being a street cop, I, a lot of the guys had nicknames given to them by the. And so you always look for that really cool name they give you, you know. So one day, all the kids, I used to narrate a football game in the street when I came on Sunday afternoons, and the kids, I'd get out. I knew the kids' names, and I'd just sit there with my police car and just tell the kids, Johnny's going deep. He's going to catch a ball. There he goes. He made it, you know. And so anyways, these were the inner city neighborhoods. And the kids came up to me one day after that and said, hey, Corson, you got your tag, man. And I go, oh, I did? He goes, yeah, the neighborhood gave you your tag. And I said, what was that? And I'm, you know, these guys have like Killer and Mac and, you know, really macho names. They came up to me and they gave me the most endearing name that I have. And he said, they call you Peacemake. And I said, Peacemake? And I go, why they call me Peacemake? And they said, because when you show up, you make peace in our neighborhood. And I said, you know, thank you, God. I mean, I didn't get the cool name, but I got the meaningful name, you know. So anyways, right after that, I was in the ministry. We had a moment, and I'll tell you that last story there is, Billy Graham in 84 came to, had his crusade. And I was working youth ministry, and I did the crusade with Billy Graham's guys. And Saturday night's usually the big night for all the youth. And so I had been working really hard to get involved with the youth on that night. And all our kids were coming. A lot of churches didn't want to participate, but I really wanted to get involved with what Billy was doing. And so that night I was supposed to be there, but my work called me up and said, hey, you can't be there. You need to be here. We have you at work. And I'm going like, this is wrong, God. I mean, I should be with his youth. That's where you got me. And so, nope, I had to go to work. So I went to work, and I drove in past, as I was coming from Riverside, past the stadium on 5, the lights on. And I was like, just, my heart was broken. But when I went there, what happened was there was a girl named Lydia that a Christian man, a little Italian man like Geppetto, came to me weeks before that and had asked me to find his daughter, that she was caught in drugs. And so when I went to work that night, I was kind of angry and not very happy to be there. And I got a call out of nowhere about a forgery. And I went there to this little seedy hotel. And long story short, I ended up finding a girl, and that girl was Lydia. And I brought her home to her parents, to her dad. Her dad was crying. She was crying. She had been overwhelmed by drugs in her life and all this other stuff. And so the only thing I did was I sat down with her and I said, Lydia, you got to change. What happened to you? And she said, I just lost my way. I can't find my way back to Christ. And I said, yes, you can. I said, all you have to do is ask him in your heart and pray for forgiveness right now and repent. And she said, how do I do that? I ran out to my car and got that Bible that I got on March 27th, 1967, when I was baptized. And I brought it in. I said, here, take this. And I said, do you want to come back? And I led her in a prayer of repentance right there. My partner's looking at me like, what are you doing? And I got down on my knees and I gave her the Bible. And her dad and her were reunited. And I learned something that night about life. Is that sometimes you can be at a Billy Graham crusade, but sometimes God wants you somewhere in particular, because he said he had us to be fishers of men, but he also wanted us to be hunters, to go out and find that lost. So he changed me in my direction of my ministry. But anyway, so I got chosen after that year. Two things happened to me. I went to back to church, and they hired a full-time minister named John Collins, who's the head of Greg Laurie's crusades right now. And John came on and he kind of replaced me at church. And so God just, for a short time, he put me at Long Beach Police Department. I got chosen for a crime suppression task force that led me to all kinds of stuff that I ended up doing. I got chosen for the SWAT team, a Metro team, a recidivist apprehension team. I was flying on helicopters, the outside of a helicopters, working with DEA. I was working undercover in the streets of Long Beach with a fake tattoo on my eye, with a big black mustache and going in with prostitutes and drug dealers. And it was a crazy life. And we arrested 4 to 40 people every night of the week. And God just decided within a couple of years after John Collins was on that, he called me back and he said, Bill, you need to come back to this ministry is yours and you need to come back to church. So for the next 2 years, I made a choice to give away everything that God gave me in police work. I quit SWAT because I needed to be there on Friday nights for the kids. I quit Metro. I went back to policing. And God supernaturally moved me to Riverside Police Department after that. And in that transition, Greg called me to full-time pastor. I was a part-time pastor all those years. And he called me into full-time pastoring. But after that, what happened was there was one other pivotal point that I have to bring up is that we went to Catalina Island with these kids every year. And I wanted to see real life changes in people's hearts. So doing ministry, sometimes it's a long road and you see ups and downs. And so what I saw in the kids one time is my guys were sitting on the back of a boat and all the leaders from our men's ministry got off the boat and went on this adventure across Catalina Islands. They had harpoons and spears and all this other stuff. And man, the senior boys were just drooling to go on an adventure, you know? So the next year I did that adventure trip. I took them across the island. Now, if you remember Greg Laurie's ministry, we get all the Christian artists. Brian Duncan was with me on a lot of my adventures and stuff. But yes, George. So what happens is that when we get to that point is that I see God just show up on this adventure trip. I didn't need to preach, teach. All of a sudden, these kids started asking questions. Kids that had never been at the church, kids that were at the church. They started talking about the Bible. And by that night, after playing Frisbee on the beach, after going through herds of buffalo and wild pig and carrying our surfboards 7 miles across the island, we get to camp, and that evening, these kids are continuing to talk, and they go, "Hey, Pastor Bill, can you tell us what this about the Bible?" So I open up the Bible. We have a Bible study, and the kids basically go, the young men say, "What do we do?" And what do I say? What Peter said, repent and be baptized. And so they repented. They gave their life to Christ, a bunch of them, and they said, "What do we do now?" They said, "You said repent and be baptized. Can we be baptized?" And I said, "Sure." So we were at 10:30 at night baptizing kids in the Pacific Ocean. And that was the beginning of our outdoor adventure ministry. And God moved us to Riverside, California. I think I got a couple minutes here.
No, we got to run, Bill.
Okay. I think that was 15 minutes.
We need to finish up the rest of your story. We've got so much more to learn, but you have been used of God in some powerful ways, in some frightening ways, and in some real blessed ways. And I'll tell you what, when I see your son, Blair, whom I know fairly well now, I can see what God has done through you. I mean, what a dad you are. What a great father you are. And we just bless him. I know it is. Thank you. Thank you for being with us today. Here's another dad that's quite a dad. His name is Dan Loney. Dan has a company up in BC. It's one of the 6 top financial management companies in the province. And in 2018, Loney Financial was inducted into the Wealth Professionals Hall of Fame, only one of 11 such firms. And currently, I can't believe this, guy is running 7 separate enterprises at the same time, and he's working us in today. Would you please welcome with a thumbs up my friend Dan Loney from British Columbia. Dan, are you there?
I'm here, George. Thank you.
I want to know what you thought of our little Canadian Open today.
Well, I felt so honored. And, you know, I just was waiting for the hockey puck to drop. That's what got me going.
Dan, you and I have known each other for a dozen years or so. And yeah. I love the way you light up a room. And I love the way you keep so many plates spinning at the same time, and you're doing such meaningful stuff with your life. When did you first realize that God was preparing you to do something so remarkable with your years?
Well, I think, George, there there was a time of life, busy time of life, where, you know, we had five small young kids, and the goal was just to keep the cornflakes on the breakfast table tomorrow morning, right?
Yeah.
Along, I think one of the defining moments was when I went through Arrow, and I think you're familiar with Arrow and leadership. And when I was graduating from Arrow in Georgia in 2011, I remember we had had some changes in our business, and I really wanted to drill down the deep dive on leadership. So that's why I went through their 18-month program. And some things had changed in my business and that I really felt, well, why did I do this, God? Because it didn't feel like I was now in a place where I'd signed up for all of this. And it was our convocation evening. I was by myself. Most of the graduates had their spouses there, and they're from all around the world. And I went and sat in a boardroom, and I said, you know, Lord, what's going on? And my phone rang at that very moment. And it was a fellow in Canada, Bob Cheatley, who was the chairman of the board of Focus on the Family Canada. And he said, Dan, he said, we just came out of executive committee meeting. And he said, we've selected you to be the next chairman of the board of Focus in Canada. Would you consider that? And I think that's when it hit me that God was saying, okay, kid, suit up. I want you on the court now. And I got the tap. And I think that's when the leadership issue really started to become front and center with me.
What was it like, Dan, growing up for the young Dan Loney? Were you from a huge family like you have now?
No, I was mom and dad and a little sister, 4 years younger than me. I think boredom was the worst enemy in my life. I was a busy little guy, drove everybody nuts, lots of energy, and grew up in a northern town up in British Columbia. And during the 60s, my father started with one man and one truck and built one of the top five electrical companies in Western Canada by 1971. Then at 14 years old, I came home from school one day, mom sat me down and said, Danny, I got some bad news for you. I said, what's going on, mom? She says, well, your father's plane is missing. My father had corporate aircraft that he flew around in, and turned out that they had crashed and everybody on board was killed. So my life really changed at that point at age 14.
What did you get from your dad, Dan, up until age 14? And what did you miss by not having him?
My father was my hero. He was an amazing man. You know, George, you said I light up a room if I walked in. Well, my dad would explode the room when he walked in. He just had an amazing command, compassion, presence. He built a multi-million-dollar corporation with a grade 8 education. And he I know why today, because of my mentorship with Bob Beal over the last 20 years and the time, I understand why my father was so successful. He was a master team builder. He would search out the best people in the world to build hydroelectric dams or towers or that type of thing. But the one lesson he left with me, I will never forget. He gave me a pick one day, and he had me in this driveway dig up this tar. It just seemed to be a useless, empty job. And it was a hot day, and I was probably 10 years old, and he came along and said, Dad, this is such hard work. And he said, son, I want you to remember something. Never, ever give up. And that became the motto of my life. That became one of the most defining moments that my father spoke into my life, that no matter where you are in life, no matter what the chips are against you or whatever you feel, there's that call to never, ever give up. Because the moment you give up, you limit God. But if you don't give up, you don't limit God.
You have so many areas in your life, Dan, where you could give up easily. And a lesser man would have done it a long time ago. Do you have a cheerleader in your life? Do you have a small group of men who come alongside you and get a kick in the rear when you need it?
I have from time to time. To have that support is wonderful. I've just found that with my miles an hour, and you know, it doesn't always work for me to be able to attend a group or something like that. But I do have a couple mentors in my life that I meet with regularly. And of course, one is my relationship with Bob Beal, who's going to be your speaker. I will try and be on that call. I've followed Bob halfway around the world to Europe, anywhere, just to be in the presence of a man that has spoke so much into my life. And I have a spiritual mentor too, a man of God that, you know, he understands me. He built a $6 billion company in 15 years and retired at age 50 because he just wanted to be in the ministry. That's all he wanted to do. And I just found that spending lunch with him once a month on a regular basis has really spoken into my life. When I have theological questions or things like that, I get together with my other friend, Bob, and just have some fellowship. So, and I also have a sense of accountability to him as well. So
I know that you can talk about Bob Beal for hours and hours, but it's been a goal of mine to get the men of his deal introduced to his resources. And we have many of them on our site. What can you tell us about the advantages that you've picked up down through the years? You don't have to get to specific tools, but give us a macro view of what Bob has done to impact your life.
Well, Bob has given me tools to address every situation that can communicate. Einstein said that simplicity is the greatest genius. And Bob has an amazing ability to take complex situations and simplify them right down to a sentence. I'll give you one example. I got asked to speak at a breakfast meeting, and most of the people in that audience I didn't even know. And I was asked to, our friend Carson Pugh asked me to speak years ago, and he said, could you speak just for about 15, 20 minutes? So I got up and I spoke on a concept that Bob taught me called clarify, don't confront. And it was how often when we get into a confrontational situation, we choose sides and who we're going to support and help the other side see that this, and what Bob taught me was don't do that. You sit down with both parties and drill down on the facts. And 50% of the time, the whole issue, the whole controversy will go away. And so I talked about that in that simple process, that slogan, clarify, don't confront. I got back to my office, went through the day. Later on that afternoon, I got an email from somebody in the audience. They said, Dan, you don't know me, but I sat in your talk this morning at the breakfast. And I got back to the office this morning, and there was a major fire going on in our company. I sat down both parties and said, would you please state your facts? And did not allow the other party to talk. And then I said, would you please state your facts? Did not allow the other party to talk. He said, just the facts being stated, the fire went away. And he says, amazing. So thank you very much. So simplistic things where Bob is giving me tools that are ready to hit the road and I can use them right away. So
this is a pandemic that we are all living under right now. It seems to be driven by confusion and hatred and fear, but it's got to be replete with opportunities. What opportunities do you see for us as believers at a time such as this?
Well, Peter Drucker said this year's good surprise is next year's opportunity. And some of the consulting work that we're doing in our consulting company is to say, in this pandemic, what has surprised you that has not turned out bad, but actually been good? And for example, in our financial company, this pandemic forced our industry in Canada to accept DocuSign. where we can meet with clients online, complete all the needed paperwork that we need to do online and have them electronic signature. So it's a huge advancements into our industry and a real opportunity. Now, I think about your group here this afternoon. And George, I'm on here, and if I scan through there, I've got like three screens of men here. I realize something, George. You can have 1,000 men on here. This is a wonderful time of fellowship to hear a testimony like Bill's testimony. Bill, you made me think of Bob Vernon. When I was 14 years old, I met Bob Vernon, the captain of the LA Police Department, to think about the wise words that he spoke, that I still have that image of Bob Vernon to this day. But what an opportunity for your ministry here to reach out to men with the solution for life. And something that we're actually doing is developing tools to go into companies and organizations that will have task teams to find the opportunity. Then how do we develop that opportunity going into 2021?
You spoke about your counseling ministry, Dan. What are some of the primary issues that men are facing these days that you're working with them on?
Well, it's a consulting company, and to answer that question for leaders, it comes back to generally fog, fatigue, and flirtations. That leaders, when you have stress in your life, they're caused by major factors of indecision or lack of control. So right now we have COVID, which is a lack of control. We can't control. We've had to cancel events that were sold out for us. We've had to change things just because of our lack of control. So that can create stress. And then when the stress does its work in your life, it begins to create fatigue. You get worn out. And then once you get worn out, you start to make poor decisions. Now, George, you fully understand the basketball world, having observed it professionally for so many years. Have you often wondered, when we look at just an amazing basketball player in my world, the hockey world, make a bad pass, and you think, what was that all about? And we know from physiology and training athletes that fatigue creates an environment where we start to make bad decisions. And it's the same way in the executive world, the same way in the leadership world, that if we allow ourselves to become fatigued, we'll start to flirt with bad ideas and bad decisions. So that's what we see, is we see the confusion, the fog, we see fatigue, and then we see people flirting with bad ideas.
Bob has got a new book out, Decades by Decades.
Yes.
It just sheds so much light on life. And in a sense, it helps you make sense of every stage of life, and predict almost what's going to happen in that stage of life so that you're not taken totally by surprise. Talk to us about that book, and I'm sure you're probably teaching it right now.
Yes, actually that book has created a lot of speaking opportunities for me. I didn't realize it, but I give that book out by the hundreds. It is an amazing book. And what it talks about is that every decade of our life has a major theme. So the first 10 years is safety. And by the way, when Bob wrote the book, he sent me the manuscript, emailed it me, and I was on a flight to Guatemala. And I read the book. And when I got there, I was thinking, no, Bob's missed it. It's not about safety. The most important thing in your life, first decade, is love. And I was standing at our orphanage with about 100 little kids, looking at these little girls and little boys. And then I realized, I said, you know what? A lot of these little children were loved, but they weren't safe. And Bob's right. You've got to have children raised on a platform of safety. And a lot of kids grew up tough ghettos. Their mamas loved them, but they weren't safe. And so first decade is safety. Second decade is self, you know, kids, selfies, all of that. Teenager, what am I all about? Trying to find themselves. Where do they fit in their social setting? The 20s, that decade is about survival, because you've gone from the teenage world into the adult world, and you're trying to survive in your 20s. And by the way, I've always said that 20s is not about figuring out what you want to do. It's about figuring out what you don't want to do. I get 20-year-olds coming to me, 28, 27. They go, oh, I just can't figure out. I said, well, you've done this. You've just realized a whole bunch of things you don't want to do. That's progress. You're making progress. By the time we hit our 30s, we then, it's about success. We figured out something we want to do. Now we're focusing on success. Our 40s, it's about significance, living a significant wife. But it's significant / stress, because 40s are your most stressful years. You've got teenagers, most heart attacks, most divorces, most negative things that happen in families all happen in our 40s. By your 50s, you hit your stride. If you've done what you've been doing for 20 years, you could do it on autopilot in your sleep, and you're really good at it. By the 60s, you want to become very strategic. I find that one of the most strategic words in my life now is the word no, because every time I say yes to something, I have to say no to something else. And, you know, running 7 divisions in the Loney Group, having raised birthed, adopted, and raised 36 children. We still have 12 children at home, 14 in the house. It's a very, very busy life. And throw a couple hockey games in there, you know, every week in the winter, and a little bit of golf in the summer. I got to learn to, I'm now becoming strategic, whereas before I would just tackle everything. 70s, I'll focus on succession. 80s is a little bit slippery because of health. Right, George? You get some health challenges. There's no man has a lease on life. And then 90s is sleep. So I look at life 0 to 30 is the first period as a hockey player. Second period is 30 to 60. I'm in the third period of my life. Want to finish well. You win hockey games in the third period. You win football games in the fourth quarter. And then if God blesses me with overtime, well, we'll see what happens. Overtime is sudden death, as you know.
Right. Boy, the Canucks got a dandy goal last night in the first minute.
They did. And the linesman, number 79, is my client. And I have the pleasure of texting him after the game. We had a little bit of dialogue. And he calls them mini. And he says they're a very cantankerous group, very good hockey club. But, yeah, he made a call in that game, which they weren't too happy about. Coville fell on the puck, and he called it passing it with his hand out of the faceoff. So Kyle's the guy that made that call. But it was a good game. It was fun to see them win. We'll see what happens. Thursday is going to be a little testy, that's for sure.
Yeah. We've got to have some questions from around the room. You guys like McCahill, and Spear, and Glover, and Stein, and Marcus. What questions do you have for Dan?
George, can I make a comment while they're thinking about their question?
You bet.
You know, I speak, and they always want a biography, right? And they go, well, he did this. He's in the Hall of Fame, and he's helped build this orphanage. He's has all these kids. He's done that. But one thing I want to really point out, you know, I'm a guy that one of my sons has been in the psych ward twice. He's a genius, has an IQ of 165, and I know what it's like to sit in a psychiatric unit with a brilliant computer software engineer that's blown a fuse. I had a son on drugs involved with gangs and the mafia. He made $100,000 tax-free a month. And I had a contract on his life. He actually came to me one day, and he met me at a Starbucks, and uncharacteristically said, I want to have a coffee with you. And I said, well, what's going on? He said, Dad, I just come to say goodbye because I have a contract on my life, and they'll get me. There's no way I can get away from this. I sat in a thoracic surgeon's waiting room to find out about cancer. Going in for a cancer operation. I've had all kinds of things in life. There's a lot that I've experienced on the good side and the bad side. And so, and then, you know, I got, once I was introduced to this group of mayors and member of parliaments, and they asked me to speak before 300 business executives and that, and they read my bio, and I got up and I looked at them all and I said, actually, my 85-year-old mother wonders why you're all here today. And because she said, who would ever want to listen to you? You know, so just to say, yeah, there's that bio. God has done amazing things, but quite a lot of hardships, he is faithful. He has answered our prayers. And in life, for every challenge that we have come across, I now look at that challenge as a rock in the river, a big rock. And I was in a rapids once. I went whitewater rafting with my sons and got tossed out of the raft in a level 5 category rapids, and know what it's like to go down the river without a raft and have these big rocks coming at you. But what I've learned is that if Father does not remove the rock, by his grace, he raises the river. Mm. And he helps me through the tough times that I can get through. And that river is his grace. So here we are in COVID. I have peace that passes understanding. I fully encourage one to just seek a deeper relationship with Jesus Christ, because he is a wonderful Lord and Savior. And that's my testimony.
And you're sticking to it.
And I'm sticking to it. That's right.
Good. How about some questions, some feedback? What do you think of what you heard?
I see some on the chat, George and Dan. Jim Spear wants to know if retirement is a biblical idea.
Well, that's a great question, and I don't believe it is. We actually don't even use the word retirement in our planning and our discussions. We use the word transition, because where in the Bible do you find, okay, let's talk about Samson. When he retired, what happened? Well, he went down with all the Philistines, his ministry was over, and his life was over. When Moses retired, got the children to the land of Canaan, what happened? The Lord took him out. When Jesus had fulfilled his ministry, there was no retirement. He was taken. And on and on and on. So no, I don't believe that we retire. And I'm absolutely convinced. This morning, when I studied the scriptures early this morning, Paul, I was reading the Corinthians, he says, you know, the manifest power of God is really most available in my weakness. And I feel that as we get older, the more important things come to light. And the greatest thing that we can, you know, we need to get something out of our vocabulary, and it's the words, well, all we can do is pray. Yeah. We need to get that out of our vocabulary, because I believe that prayer is the highest calling that any of us could have. And I used to fear that Jesus would take me inside and say, well, you know, well done, thou good and faithful servant, but come here, I want to show you a video of what you could have done if you'd really, really trusted me. And I always felt some condemnation, but a good friend of mine by the name George on this call took me inside, showed me that scripture, therefore there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ. So when I meet Jesus, we're just going to hug, weep, and cry, and laugh, and enjoy the moment.
We're getting a bunch of questions here. Marcus Norton wants to ask, Dan, at what point did you realize your faith and business not only could coexist, but could abundantly thrive together? At what point?
Yeah, I think one of the turning points for me was reading the biography of George Mueller. George Mueller built an orphanage in England that to over 10,000 children went through. And in a time when there were no orphanages, there were 6,000 children in the 1800s incarcerated in British prisons. So these are not youth detention juvenile homes. Bill, you'd be familiar with that, but this is prison. So you stole bread, you went to prison. And Charles Dickens, who wrote Oliver Twist, actually visited Mueller and wrote about the plight of these children and Oliver Twist. But I think it was reading his biography and his watching his dependence and faith on God. He never asked for a penny. God supplied all his need. And I thought, well, if God could do that for Mueller, why couldn't he do that in my business?
We got two great questions from Ed McCahill. I love this one. Dan, if you could get a mulligan in life, what would you do over?
Wow, that is a great question. Thank you for that. I'm gonna steal that one. Yeah. Let me just think about that for a second. I think if what comes to mind, I never had a formal education because I never respected it. My father built a corporation with a grade 8 education, and I thought, well, I can do the same. And I'm autodidact, so I'm self-taught, self-learned. Everything I've learned, I've either signed up for the course or put myself through. But I had a university education paid for. I never went because I started my first business when I was right up, pretty much out of high school, selling fitness equipment. There was no such store in Canada. And I'd seen one in Vine Nuys, California. I thought, what a great idea. Went home, started with a friend, and built that business up to 86. And we sold that in 1986 or 87. So one desire would be, I'd love to get a formal education. Like I'd love to get a MBA or get a degree in leadership or something like that. That's one mulligan I would play. And if I had another one, it would be, when I started my financial business, I was so terrified of failure. I worked 15 hours a day. I'd change that. I'd work smarter, knowing what I know today, and I'd spend more time with my kids. My kids grew up, or my original five are doing great, all of them. But we'll sit around and kids will say the story. They're all adults now, but they say, hey, Mom, you remember this and that? And they'll go, and I'll go, I don't remember that. When was that? And she apologetically or kind of looks at me and she says, sweetie, it's okay. You were at work, you know, so I would change that.
Okay. And a final question from Ed is, with so many accomplishments, Dan, what do you think your legacy will be?
Wow. I hope that my legacy will be some form of inspiration, that I would live a life that would inspire others to serve Christ and walk in Christ's footsteps and apply that, whatever calling in life they have, whether it's ministry, whether it's business, whether it's service, no matter what they're doing, whether they're a pilot, you know, whatever they're doing, I just hope to live a life that would inspire others to follow Christ and to trust him.
Dan, we have a question from, or a statement from somebody here. I don't know if he wants to be known or not. It says it's to everyone, but I'm not going to reveal his name. I don't know whether you can see the chat list or not. I'm that new to Zoom. But he says, trying to live in faith makes me feel like such a failure because I'm always failing. What do you say to that, brother?
Well, what I would do is, I would start out by looking at being really open to God and saying, you know, if I'm going to do something, Lord, I want to remove my feelings and my biases about this. Father, do you want me in this? I want to show me through your word, lead me through your Holy Spirit, through providential circumstances, that this is of you and that what you want me to do. And once that's established in your heart, I then would, I would lay it out before the Lord and I would trust him, if it was starting a business or if it, whatever that ministry, whatever it is, I would have a clear vision. I'd write down that clear vision of what it is that we're trying to do here. And I would say, Lord, keep me on track with that vision. And I would bring all of my needs before the Lord. And you know, I forget how the scripture says, but it says by the ear first and then the corn. It talks about the corn. You develop it step by step. So don't start out by something huge. Start out by the little things, trusting God with the little things. and just committing them to him. And you're going to find out things about yourself, but that's how I would start.
Romans 4 says, happy are those whose wrongs are forgiven, whose sins are pardoned. Happy mm-hmm. is the person whose sins the Lord will not keep account of.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
He is not watching for your failures.
No.
The song says, the only view God has to make is through the blood of Jesus.
Yeah.
When God sees you, he sees you through his son, if you're a follower of Christ. And so he doesn't see a failure for his son, because he has taken all of your sin and put it on his son's shoulders at the cross, and all of his son's righteousness and put it in you, reckoned it to your account.
Yeah.
So God is not waiting to pounce on you, and he's not counting your sins. What he is looking at these days, Graham Cook points out so well in his books, is that he's working on the part of you that isn't like Christ yet.
Yeah.
Because when you step over the transom, as Pat O'Day did last night, into eternity,
yeah,
you're going to have a glorified body, no illness, no sin, no sorrow, and God and the Holy Spirit, the Father and the Holy Spirit, are working on us today to get us ready for that moment. Is that
George? We talked about that earlier this week, George, when I was out for a walk. Remember?
Yeah.
And we had that conversation, and that blessed me so much that when I was walking to meditate on the fact that all my sin is forgiven, not only the sins of the past, but if I err in transgression today and I look to the Lord, it's forgiven. And I don't have to worry about, I just need to keep my heart on following him. And I think for that brother that asked that question about failing so many times, yeah, there's times I fail. There's times that I'm disappointed with what I said or did or something like that. And yet the Father just loves me so much. And I just feel him saying, go on, kid, go on. And you know, George, I was so blessed by that when I was walking, meditated, I felt goosebumps. I felt like I could rip my clothes off and dance before the Lord. I was so happy, because that scripture says, happy is he, right? I was so happy. But fortunately, sense prevailed, and I was just joyously walking and worshiping the Lord. But that's the life he's given us. He's given us a life of joy. He's given us a life, I believe it's all about submission to him and following him, just trusting him.
You know, we have a pastor with us today, my friend Jedediah Johnson. And Jedediah may want to correct me here hermeneutically or exegetically. But, you know, we die once, and after that, the judgment. And Christ died on the cross to cover all our sins. Therefore, why do we tell people who are already ask God to forgive you your sins? They're already forgiven. We just read that in Romans 4. Why do we want to live with a conscious awareness of am I sinning all the time? It doesn't mean that we shouldn't live righteous lives. But we give away our, I'm going to say, ignorance of what happened at the cross. What happened at the cross? He dealt with sin once and for all. Hebrews tells us he's not going to put him on the cross again. So when you come to Christ as a believer, I think you say, God, I really screwed up there. I'm sorry for that. I don't want to do that again. Thank you that you've already forgiven me.
Amen. Amen. And you know, I had a revelation in a hotel room in 2004 in Bogota, Colombia. I'll never forget it. How do we walk in victory? How do we walk a life that's pleasing to the Lord? And the Lord showed me in a simple scripture, be filled with the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. Yeah. So rather on us focusing what we're not supposed to do, we need to focus on being filled with the Spirit in the presence of God. If we're filled with the Spirit in the presence of God, then we won't do those things that disappoint our Savior. And I, you know, it's just, it's like a marriage. My wife, I want to please her. I want to bless her. I want to do things that because I love her. So it's good.
Dan, we have a question here. How do you rest? How do you recharge?
Yes. So one thing I think is really important. I have made for the last 30 years of my life, I'm 63, 40 years. I've been interested in human performance from an athletic point of view. I've been a kickboxer, I've been in the hockey, played over 15, 20 international hockey matches, and was a powerlifting champion way back in the day. And just been had an interest in how do we maximize our performance. And that went over into the executive world. And violated early in my youth was sleep. I actually tried to train myself to sleep on 4 hours a night, because then that gave me a whole new 4 hours to work in my business and doing it. That was disastrous. That lasted for about 2 years, and then I ended up in the hospital and they thought I had a stroke and all kinds of problems. And Jesus was very adamant about rest, that rest is important. And so I focus on good sleep, good preparatory habits before going to sleep. I do some crazy things. I have a mat that I lay on. It's like a 1,000 bed of nails, but it's like these little pin things that increase the blood flow in your body and that. And I'll often have a really hot shower or bath before. Really focus on a really good night's sleep. And then I used to set my alarm clock at 4:30 in the morning. I don't do that anymore. I just wake up when my body's restored. And sometimes, you know what? Sometimes I wake up at 3 a.m. And sometimes I wake up at 8 a.m., you know, if I push the limit too much. But number one is sleep. Number two, for me, hockey has been a wonderful, restful thing that just allows me to offset the pressures of life. You know, I get out on a hockey rink for an hour and a half. You don't have time to think about your problems when some big guy's barreling down on you to lay a check on you. And golf. Lately, I've found that golf is a wonderful 4.5 hours of just walking and talking with the Lord. And I'm getting a little better. I got golfer's elbow right now, so I'm on the sidelines at the moment. But those two things. And then the other third thing that I love to do is I sit on my deck, and I really enjoy reading because I love to learn. So have a coffee and sit on my deck.
On your website, Dan, you have listed the books that you've been reading. And so guys can go to loneyfinancial.com if they want to see a great bibliography. Tell us about Guatemala. What's going on down there, and how did you get involved?
2005, I got asked to go to Guatemala for a client to consult for him in a meeting. And I didn't want to go. I told him no four times. And I said, they shoot people down there. I'm not going there. Uh-huh. And I have this crazy bucket list, George, as you know, and I saw a soccer game in Europe with the riot police and the flares and the smoke and everything and the barbed wire fences. And I asked this gentleman, this client, I said, well, do they have those soccer games with the barbed wire fence and the riot police and all that? Sort of like going to run with the bulls, right? He said, oh, yeah. I said, okay, tell you what, you get me in the soccer game, I'll go to your meeting, two-hour meeting in Guatemala. So night before I left, I was sort of lamenting my decision, went to my wife, who I call my barefoot prophet, in the kitchen and said, honey, it makes no sense why I'm going to Guatemala for a two-hour meeting to shoot people down there. She says, yeah, I know, honey. I know, but when you go there, God will reveal to you why you're there. And I want to show you something. So she took me in the living room. She showed me a suitcase that she filled with $300 full of dolls, toys, coloring books, crayons, that kind of thing. She says, I want you to take this to an orphanage. There's lots of orphanages in Guatemala. So I flew to Guatemala. My client got his contract. That was good. I said, I need help to go to an orphanage somewhere to deliver the suitcase. They arranged for a lady to pick me up, took me to a house where a woman for 4 years had been taking, a retired American teacher had been taking little girls off the street, tattered dresses, barefoot, begging for food. And when I met her, she had 22 of these little girls in the house. So heard the story, wonderful, got to the house, met Mama Carol, said, I hardly even know what's in here, but God bless you, what you're doing, it's great. And I had my agenda, was to go back to my 5-star hotel, have a workout, had a beautiful gym, spa, have a back rub, swim, to go for a steak dinner. And she says to me, no, you can't leave, you gotta come meet the girls. And I went, my heart fell, but I didn't wanna be rude, so went in. Then she says, I want you to give out all the toys. Do you know what she was doing? Well, I handed out these toys, and the girls just screamed. And it really touched me, because my wife and I had just adopted two little girls of Honduran descent. So I had two little cuties like that, I call them my cinnamon girls. And then that was great, but not life-changing. But what happened next changed my life. She took me through the house. Now, this is 2005. This is before human trafficking was in the news and all the rest of it, before my friend Brian McConaughey at Ratnak Foundation in Cambodia and all the work that they do with sex trafficking and all that. This is 2005, and Mama Carol took me through the house, introduced me to the girls one by one, told me their stories. Well, as a man in my 50s, early 50s, I had never even once thought about a 6-year-old girl in prostitution. Wasn't aware of it, never even crossed my, never heard of it. And I'm a hockey player. I wanted to grab a hockey stick and just go after these guys. And I actually said to her, I said, Mama Carol, I had to bite my lip. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. You know, it's one thing to hear these stories, but when you know those little precious faces in front of you, those little gems in front of you, to hear what they went through. I said to her, why don't just a group of men get baseball bats and go after these guys? It's a very unchristian thing to say. But I guess the hockey player came out at me in that moment. And with sorrowful eyes, she looked at me and she said, Dan, you don't get it. These girls were put in prostitution, most of them by their mothers, because it's a cycle that has gone on. Well, the only motherhood I know is my mother, my wife, my mother-in-law. Wonderful examples of what a mom is all about. I went back to my hotel room that night. And I just wept. I wept. I phoned my wife. I was a mess. And you know what? I'm supposed to be a tough guy. You know, hockey player, ex-kickboxer, broken noses, broken cheekbones, all of that. Been through all of that. And I wept. And I was heartbroken. And that night, I got down on my knees beside my bed. And I said, Jesus, I want to follow you. I want to be true to you. But I want to go and kill somebody right now. I'm so angry at what is happening to these little girls. I want to go and kill somebody. I want to go after these guys and stop this. And the Lord spoke to my heart that night, and it was this. He said, Dan, I have rescued those little girls, and I have saved those little girls, and I'm healing those little girls. But I want you to know something. I hung on a cross, not only for them, but for the perpetrators that have violated them. Broke my heart. That the worst of sinners, Jesus died for, hung on the cross for them, for me. And I had amazing peace come into my life that night. Went home. Got home, and the story goes back 30 years now, 35 years prior to that, where my father, one Saturday morning, came in, sat on the edge of my bed, started talking to me, and he said, son, I'm going to sell my company. I'm 13 years old at that point. And I said, oh, okay. I'm kind of waking up, and I said, Dad, what are you going to do? And he said, I don't know, but I'm going to do something with you, son. And I said, okay. What are you going to call it? He said, well, I'm going to call it, we'll call it J.R. Loney and Son. My dad's name was James Ralph Loney. And then he said something to me I never forgot. He said, and son, you know what we're going to do? We're going to build an orphanage for kids. We're going to help a bunch of kids. And I said, oh, okay, Dad. And then he got up and he walked out of my room. I never forgot that. A year later, his corporate airplane crashed into a mountain. He and everybody on board were killed. And I sat on a cliff overlooking the water where we lived. Our house was on a high cliff, Tawasin. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to keep my dad had a dream to help children. So I'm going to I'm going to fulfill that dream. One day I'm going to build a house for kids. And we're going to, I figured what I'd do is work at a job all my life. And then I would sell my house, take the money, build this house for children. And then I would live in an apartment or something. At least I fulfilled my dream. Well, I didn't. And when I married Joy, she was 18 years old. I had to wait for her to turn 18 right out of high school. I was a very mature 22. And I said, oh, by the way, on her wedding day, I said, honey, one thing we have to do is build an orphanage in memory of my father. She said, oh, that's fine, dear. So, I mean, what would an 18-year-old bride say? And I flew back and I said to Joy, Joy, I think I know where we're supposed to build that orphanage now. So flew back. And when I was flying back to Guatemala, I usually always sit in the aisle seat because I'm a bigger guy and I got a little more boardroom. But I remember I was in a window seat this flight, looking out at 39,000 feet and praying this prayer. I said, Father, I have no idea what I'm doing. I want to go help this lady. Her dream is to build an orphanage. And 22 girls crammed into this house. Please help me. Give me some kind of sign. Got to Guatemala, took Mama Carol out for lunch and said, Mama Carol, my wife and I have decided to come alongside you financially and prayerfully to support your dream of building an orphanage. And she wept. She ate lunch table, just wept. And she said, Dan, I'm so thankful that you've decided to help me with the James Project. Well, when she said James Project, I nearly fell out of my chair because that was my dad's name. But she named it James Project from James 1:27, that true religion is taking care of widows and orphans in their distress and keeping oneself unspotted from the world. So that's today. We have 15 acres, serve 4,000 meals a month. We have 100 children, you know, take or give a little bit, 100 children. And then we have a project in a town about 2 hours away, a youth center that my friend built. We helped with that. And we have about 70, 80 kids that come for food every day, a little bit of schooling and hear the gospel. So that's Guatemala.
Dan, we have about 2.5 minutes. Tell us about what's going on in Peru. I have no idea what you've got going there.
In Peru?
Peru Project?
No, nothing in Peru.
Well, I must have been hearing things. Okay, I asked you earlier this week, what are the three major sandboxes that you're playing in at this time? And you told me the Word of God, prayer, and allowing God to be your CEO. Give us a couple minutes on that.
So I've committed to a life of prayer, and I look at all my goals as minimum, medium, and what I call my max goal or mega goal. And I just felt, you know, I've heard people say, well, you don't say I'm going to spend 60 minutes with your wife. It's more, you know, spontaneous, but no, Jesus said to Peter and the disciples, could you guys spend an hour? So I've committed to spend a minimum hour every day with the Lord. And there's many examples of prayer in the Bible, and I've made a 20 year study of prayer. And I'm just trying to model my life after the life of Daniel. Daniel was an immensely successful individual. So if I can get 3 times of prayer in today, that would be the perfect day. I don't always, but I just find, as you know, George, I in the morning, like this morning, I went a prayer walk. And that prayer walk was at a little bit behind schedule. So I went from 7 to 8, but I took my 7-year-old son with me. And as we walked, I taught him to pray. I taught him to pray for mom. I taught him to pray for his brother, that we would have that conversational prayer with the Father and just developing those relationships. So number one is prayer. And that's, you know, where it all starts.
Dan, you've got so many more things that I wanted you to share with us, but we don't have time. Tell us when you have a Leadership Academy coming up this fall. Is that right?
Yeah, we have Leadership Academy. And we were going to go with September, but because of the COVID as a moving target, we just don't know that people would be able to attend with our provincial laws and social distancing. But we're looking at November right now. So we will put that on our website, loneyleadership.com. We'll announce when that is. And then I'll be in October. I'll be in Scottsdale with Bob teaching the consulting institute there.
We're going to wrap up in just a minute, but first I want you to listen to this Merle Haggard song. This is just amazing. Listen to these lyrics.
Like the ancient Roman Empire, this world is doomed to fall. And it's much too big a thing for mortal man. Just take a look around and see the writing on the wall. Somehow we've got to find the helping hand. This world has never been in the awful shape it's in. And people scorn the things our leaders do. It's time a prayer was spoken from the heart of every man. Jesus, take a hold and lead us through. The mighty roar of gunfire is now a local sound. And our city streets are filled with angry men. Laws now mockery throughout our troubled land. And destruction seems to be the current trend. This world has never been in the awful shape it's in. And our leaders seem in doubt of what to do. It's time a prayer was spoken from the heart of every man. Jesus, take a hold and lead us through. Jesus, take a hold and lead us through.
Dan, any closing words for us?
Well, thank you for this opportunity to be with all you guys today. I think about you all around, you know, the United States and wherever you're coming in from. And I would just encourage, we just want to encourage everybody to follow in the Lord's steps and read His Word and just trust Him. Even when things don't make sense, just trust Him. He will never fail you. He's never failed me in 63 years, never. And I have that faith and confidence in Him that He won't fail you either.
What will some of you guys take away with you today? Let's turn on your mics and a nugget that you got from Dan or Bill.
Well, this is Mark Wheeler, and you know, I can appreciate the ministry supporting rescued girls. My wife and I do the same through our church in Cambodia, and it touches your heart and what you want to do. I had the same reaction that you had when I first saw that. I said, I just want to go out and beat somebody up, but. God definitely has softened my heart towards these young girls, and it's a blessing just to be part of their lives. It's been over 5 years now, so we've had a chance to watch them grow up and to pour into them. So I can relate to that ministry.
Thanks, Mark. We're going to wrap up here because I told people that we'd be done at 1:30. But let me just say that this Zoomcast will be posted on HisDeal.org on our homepage under August 2020 videos. Special thanks to Dan Loney, who gave of his valuable time today and his heart. And his website is Loney, L-O-N-E-Y, loneyfinancial.com. To Bill Corson, we didn't get to talk much about outdoor adventure centers, but we sure had a fascinating look at this guy's wonderful life. And God has blessed you with such four beautiful children and a great ministry. And the website is outdooradventurescenters.com, outdooradventurescenters.com. Thanks to Walter Powers and to our technical director, Joe Hinckley. Above all, I want to thank you men for being here. May God bless you and keep you until we reconnoiter again on August 26th with Executive Mentor Bob Beal. And until then, remember, when it comes to anything and everything, it's all his deal. Mm-hmm.